already there. Got a little anxious, did you? Little title. Guess we'll get started. AM Radio Now, episode 201. Embedded Kickstarter for the 2015 ARRLN Tapper Digital Communications Conference. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Back from Hawaii. Back from Dayton. Talk about all that in a couple of minutes. The studio has been dark. Guess you could see that a moment ago. So we're finally back and getting some more episodes going. Got an email from somebody that said, excuse me, I don't mean to be too curious, but the last episode that I saw was 200 some time ago. Have I missed any? Nope, you haven't missed any. We've been busy. Let's see. So the deal here is Tapper has announced the date and the location for this year's Digital Communications Conference. It is going to be October 9th through 11th. And it will be in Arlington Heights, a suburb of Chicago. And hang on just a moment. Yes, my co-host for the episode, The Bear, has arrived. Bear, you want to sit on my lap for a little while? You going to stay there be good? We'll find out. Okay, so where were we? Oh, yes, October 9th through 11th in Arlington Heights, Illinois. It's a Chicago suburb, so I'm excited about going back to there because I grew up in Chicago. Usually the DCC is in the end of September, at least traditionally it has been. Last year in Austin, it was in the beginning of September. It depends on the availability of the hotels and the venues, and some of those things get booked up years in advance. So last year, something about college football games in the Austin area were going to tie up the venue, the Marriott that they were in. And I don't know what it is in this hotel in the Chicago area, but they're busy in end of September, but they were available in October. The topics, the schedules, the speaker schedules, not available yet. The Sunday seminar, not available. The banquet speaker, not available. Those things usually don't get firmed up until a month or so before the DCC. It's been my experience. However, the venue is firmed up, so if you can make your reservations there now, and they got a pretty good deal, $99 for a single or a double room. Chicago's the hotel is not too far from the airport, and they've got a shuttle from O'Hare Airport. And it's not a cheap place to do hotel stuff, so $100 a night is a pretty good deal. Let's see. So I need to do another Kickstarter to fund me going out to Chicago to do this. Most Ham Radio Now stuff is brought to you by you, and normally through ordinary contributions through Arvin. Arvin is not back there. No, Arvin is sitting here. We got something to talk about with Arvin in just a moment. Well, toward the end of the show. So got to do the Kickstarter to fund going out there. It's not something that I can count on normal contributions to be able to handle. We're getting to the point where maybe that would work, but for something this serious, something where I've got to expend this much money, I'd like to have it handled in advance. And you guys have been pretty good. You've handled two Kickstarters for me so far, so I have confidence that the third one is going to be successful as well. The Kickstarter actually has already been approved. Okay, so there's the Kickstarter. It has been accepted. It has not yet been launched. And I need to go make a video for it. Let me take a look at what I did last year. See if I can back that up and replay it. This is a Kickstarter project to shoot video of the entire ARRL and Tapper 2014 Digital Communications Conference coming up in September in Austin, Texas, and stick it on the web. Okay, so that's what I did last year. I guess we'll do something pretty much about the same. So I'm going to embed it right in this show. Let's do the Kickstarter thing, and then I'll come back and talk about Dayton and maybe a little bit about Hawaii, do some other stuff. people are going to be wondering why I'm wearing a Hawaiian shirt for this Kickstarter, but we'll let them wonder. This is a Kickstarter to... I'll try that again. That was bad. Everybody, this is a Kickstarter project to fund shooting video of the entire 2015 ARRLN Tapper Digital Communications Conference to be held this October in the Chicago area, and stick it on the web. I'm Gary Pierce, ham radio call sign KN4AQ. I am the host and producer of a program called Ham Radio Now. And Ham Radio Now is where the videos go for this Kickstarter. The financial goal is $10,000, and the deadline is midnight January 31st. And that is longer than the usual 30 days that is recommended for Kickstarters. The reason is that we have some corporate underwriters involved. One of the rewards that I'll talk about in a minute is for businesses, typically small businesses, but they need a little bit more time than you individuals do to figure out their budgets and decide if they're going to support something like this. So we're going to make it a little bit longer. This is a rerun. We've done this twice before. We were successful on Kickstarters and finishing the project. One of those Kickstarters that actually got all the way through to completion, both in 2013 and 2014. We've actually been shooting this event since 2008. Back then, we sold it on DVDs. So many of you know exactly what it's all about, and you're ready to head to back the project. But hang on just a minute, because I need your help with one more thing. I have simplified the rewards a little bit. It's going to be fairly self-explanatory. We'll talk about them in just a moment. But for those of you that are not familiar with this, a little bit of background on the DCC and the video. And let me pull up the DCC's website here. This is the ARRL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference website. It is a 2.5-day technical conference for ham radio enthusiasts who are interested in digital communications in amateur radio. It includes 2 days of presentations. Each of the presentations is about 40 minutes long, and they all cover some aspect of digital stuff in ham radio.
Who here is familiar with USRPs and our products? Maybe okay, not everybody, but a lot of people. So the USRPs are software-defined radios, and actually, well, here's the block diagram that still applies to this day, although it's not necessarily USB, but you have an application on one side that uses GNU radio in most cases, a computer, and then an interface to a board that then has analog components and then transverters to get you to RF frequency bands of interest.
There is a Saturday night banquet speaker, sort of a keynote speaker, and then there's a Sunday seminar. And it is typically a 4-hour talk on a single topic, so it goes into a great depth. The date is October 9th through 11th. It is in Arlington Heights, Illinois, which is a Chicago suburb. It is convenient to O'Hare Airport, and they do have a shuttle. And it's important to point out that this Kickstarter is to fund me going there to shoot video and put it on the web as part of Ham Radio Now. The Kickstarter does not fund the Tapper Conference itself. That is funded by the people who attend and the members of Tapper. So this video is, this Kickstarter is strictly for shooting the video. The video does have the blessing of Tapper and the presenters who provide the content. And again, this is the third time that I've used Kickstarter to make and fund the videos. So this year, I have simplified the reward structure just a little bit. Since we've done this a few times, I've sort of learned what rewards work and what rewards doesn't. This is not a rewards-driven project. A lot of Kickstarter projects have tiers of like this one does, have tiers of contributions, and at each level of tiers, you get a more significant reward. What we discovered in this Kickstarter and with the group of folks that support it is you're not all that reward driven. Your reward is being able to see the presentations, whether you went there live or not. There's a lot of presentations, a lot of material. If you go there live, you see it once and maybe you don't get it all. So putting it on the web gives you a chance to review and learn you know, in more depth what the presenters were talking about. And for those of you that don't have a chance to get there, then you can see what it's all about, and you can rewind and replay and do as much as you want to understand what the presenters are talking about. And let me talk about a little bit about going to the DCC versus seeing things online. When we first started making, at first DVDs and then putting things online, I talked to the folks at Tapper, primarily Steve Bible and 7HPR, who's the current president. We talked about the consideration that, well, maybe doing the videos was going to cause people to not come to the DCC because they could see it online. So why go through the time and expense of actually traveling there? He wasn't too worried about that, and it turns out he was right. Pretty much exactly the opposite has happened. The DCC has become more and more popular. Not by, you know, 10 times more popular, but a few more people have been showing up every year since we started doing the videos. And many people have said they saw what it was all about, and they realized it was something that they wanted to go to. One of the big advantages of going to the DCC in person are that you get to mingle and talk to the other attendees, people who are like-minded, people interested in the same things you are, and you can also talk to the people that are doing the presentations. These are not people up on a big pedestal somewhere. They're hams like you are, for the most part, and more than interested in talking to you about their projects and answering questions. There's a big Q&A session, usually at the end of each talk. And if you're there, you get to ask the questions. If you're not there, well, you can send email to these guys and get your questions answered, but it's not quite as cool as being there in person. All right, so it's not a really rewards-driven project for a Kickstarter, but we still sort of have some. Now, last year we tried a 30-day exclusive window of viewing if you backed the DCC at a certain level, backed the videos at a certain level. That fell apart immediately. There were a couple of talks that I put online instantly because they were news. It was Flex Radio's APIs that they had announced for, Codec 2 and just the APIs in general for Flex Radios. So we put those on immediately and so immediately violated the 30-day window of exclusivity for some of the backers. And they pretty much all said, fine, good idea. In fact, no 30-day window. Put things on right away. This is a very open source concept. Tapper is committed to open source hardware and software. Most of the folks that are involved in Tapper do the open source thing. And the idea of any kind of exclusivity was sort of in opposition to their general philosophy of the ways things should be. So we didn't do the 30-day window, and everybody was pretty much happy with that. So we're not even going to try. And that's the way it's going to work this year. $1,500 backers will get to be able to download some of the videos. You can watch them on YouTube. And all of that is free. Anybody can watch them on YouTube, whether you back the projects or not. And if you know how, you can download videos from YouTube. But if you're a $50 or $100 backer, I will give you some of the programs as downloads in their original high-definition MP4 format. Not a big deal, but it's a little bit better looking than what YouTube does because they crunch and do a little bit more compression. And finally, the $150 backers will get all of the programs on a little USB drive. And this is what it looks like. This particular one, PNY, 32 gigabyte. It's a USB 3. So this is the reward. Last year and the past couple of years, I tried to do a couple of different levels of reward with smaller and bigger drives and more and less programs. Got very complex. This year, $150 level is a USB drive with all the programs on it. Last year's $500 corporate underwriter level was pretty successful. With the $500 corporate underwriter, I talk about you for 30 seconds or so. I've usually gone far over what I promise, but I usually promise 15 seconds, maybe 30 seconds at the beginning of each program. You can send me 15 seconds of copy, you know, something to say about you, and you can send me some graphics, and nobody's ever done that. I just scarf some things off your website and I talk about you for a little bit, and that's been successful. Everybody's been pretty happy with what I've done, and that comes at the beginning of each program. However, last year we had six, and six wasn't too many to squeeze in. We were able to get that in. It took a couple of minutes. And I looked at YouTube's.
Ham Radio Now episode.
YouTube gives me some metrics of how people are watching the program, including a minute by minute summary or minute by minute evaluation of how many people are watching. And typically these programs run 45 minutes to an hour. And in programs of that length, you start out at 100%. Viewership falls off to 50% within the first couple of minutes as people are deciding whether this is something they want to watch or not. And then it slowly trickles down. About, for these programs, 25 to 30% of the audience that started makes it all the way to the end. Well, one of the things I was interested in looking at with the $500 corporate underwriters was whether people were going to skip past that or not, how much of a dip that chart was going to take before it came back up for the program. And it did. It took a little bit of a dip. Here's one of them. You get an idea what one of them looks like. It takes a bit of a dip, but then and it comes back up. But it wasn't like everybody abandoned it and zoomed on forward. Most of the audience that was watching at that part stayed through the corporate underwriter announcement, which was pretty cool. I mean, I try to make it as casual as I can and not sounding like a real commercial. You can go watch them. All of them are here on the Ham Radio Now website. It's a YouTube playlist. You can see all of the Tapper stuff on this YouTube playlist. And it makes it easy to find. So what I'm going to do this year, though, with the corporate underwriters is expand it. Last year we had six. I think we made it available for 10, but we got six corporate underwriters signed up. I'm going to make it available for 20, and that's part of the reason for extending the length of the Kickstarter, to let folks know that this is available and decide whether they want to be part of it or not. It's a fairly high profile thing to do. If you put $500 into this series of programs, I can't guarantee you're going to make your money back in terms of sales or whatever it is that your company does. It's more of an image thing. You decide if you want to be associated with this advanced level of ham radio technology. If we get 20, or even if we get 10, if we get much more than five or six, I'm not going to put everybody with 30 seconds at the beginning of each program. That would take too long. So we'll distribute it. Probably have four or five per program, and we'll rotate it to cover all of them. There are approximately 16 of them with eight on Friday, eight on Saturday. They may be able to squeeze in one more. And then on Sunday, there's the four-hour seminar, and I'll just do the promotional stuff at the beginning of that. I usually do break it up into four programs. But I'll put the promotional stuff at the beginning of the first program, and then the other two or three that round out the four-hour talk. Nothing. We just keep on going. We don't interrupt the viewer's flow of getting the information about the talks. I don't even come in at the beginning and blah 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 about anything. All right. So those are the underwriter levels. It starts at $10. You don't get anything but my thanks, appreciation for that. $25, pretty much the same thing. $50, $100, I think some download possibilities, and then $150, you get the little USB drive with everything on it. This year, or last year's DCC, it took me longer to get the USB drives out than I liked. I think the last ones got sent out in March. I really would like to have it done by the end of the year. Sometimes it's just not possible. Okay, so, and again, the longer Kickstarter window, because it takes some companies a little bit of time to make up their decision. So it closes at midnight, or 11:59 p.m., July 31st. That's on a Friday, so you don't get the weekend. The businesses that are going to make up their mind on that don't need the weekend. You might, but I thought July 31st would be a good closing date. And that is it. The clock is ticking. This is one of those tell everyone you know sort of things. Well, everyone who would care about something like this, you know, don't be a pest. Tell you what, for this one, go ahead, be a little bit of a pest. All right, that's the Kickstarter video. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, for Ham Radio Now. Over and out. No, I'm not going away. Well, that'll go on the Kickstarter. So I dropped the $2,000 level. That was successful the first year. We had three corporate contributors at $2,000. Tapper was one of them. And I think that was mostly Steve Bible saying he really wanted to get the video going. And Alacraft and Flex, both of which do software-defined radios, so they sort of had a natural tie-in. But neither one of them participated last year, and probably because I really didn't give them time to figure out what they wanted to do. I'd welcome Alacraft and Flex to come back in if they want. But the only levels available are the $500 levels. If you want to do more than the $500 level, if you want to make sure that you get your message as part of each of the programs or more than whatever the rotation is, it's easy. Get two of the $500 rewards of the 20. Take two of them or three of them or four of them if you want to do $2,000 worth. And you get more time on the program. And I'll figure it out. Let's see. I have been doing the DCC since 2008. And, you know, piled up here on the table, I've got the DVDs that I did back then. I thought it would be fun to go through these just a little bit. Let's see. This is all of 2008. And it worked out to be six programs on DVD. And here's what's left. There's, you know, there's only one DVD left of the second program, but I can make some more. Three, four, five, six. What were they from way back in 2008? DVD one was on packet radio. And these are the four programs that were in there. DVD two was on DVD two. Software defined radio. Good old Matt Edis was talking about USRP 2. You know, these are they're not quite collector's items and they're not quite classic stuff yet, but they're getting to be that way. In fact, here on DVD 3, talking about Winlink 2000, APRS, and D-Star, Vic Poor, W5SMM, passed away a couple years ago, so you won't see him anymore. And his talk about Winlink is, you know, some historic data. Rick Muthing talking about the origin of Winmore before Winmore was actually a project. Bob Breninga, WB4APR, he comes and goes in the DCC quite a bit. And Pete Lovell, AE5PL, was talking about some early stuff with D-Star. And let's see, what was on DVD number four? AMSAT and publishing. So Steve Bible was talking about SuitSat. That's also pretty historical. SuitSat 2, which this is before SuitSat 2 became Arisat 1. He was talking about what was going to go on there. Tom Clark, K3IO, AMSAT Eagle Geo. Now that is interesting. Can I push a button here? That's interesting. Tom was talking about the possibility of a geosynchronous satellite carrying ham radio. It never happened. Project Eagle didn't happen. However, at this year's Tapper banquet, there's a fella, and this will be on Ham Radio Now coming up as quick as I can get it. There's a geosynchronous satellite that apparently is going to carry ham radio. It's in the plan. It's in the works. It's not a proposal. It's on the way. Unfortunately, for those of us in North America, the footprint will not cover North America because the hams that are putting this up and the company that is putting the satellite together is in Qatar. So it's going to cover the Middle East and Europe and Africa and maybe a bit of South America, I think he said, but not North America. Anyway, some interesting historical stuff on the possibility of Eagle Geo. And then Joe Lynch was talking about writing for CQ and CQVHF, and of course CQVHF is no longer with us, at least for now. Joe Lynch still is, but he's not working for CQ. I'm having trouble pulling up the next little piece here. We did the introductory sessions in 2008, and I think we did them in 2009. We're not doing the introductory sessions anymore. It takes more crew than I've got available, so we don't do those. Last year, they didn't even have any. And what was on DVD 6? Oh, this. This is still fascinating stuff. And in fact, this is on the web now. The Sunday seminar was Phil Harmon, VK6APH, talking about, he called it Software Radio Through the Looking Glass, Development of the Mercury HPSDR Receiver. And that's pretty much classic. What he is going through is the software and the way what it took to be able to do a direct conversion software-defined receiver. Now, Tapper and the HPSDR folks have been continuing to refine these products, so they're now actually as a transceiver, and you can buy one sort of as a, I'm not sure if it's a kit or a fully built-up software-defined radio, but it has been made into a sort of commercial product, not by one of the big manufacturers, but you can get it. But Phil was talking about what it took to be able to make a direct conversion software-defined receiver. By direct conversion, we mean something that takes the RF in through the antenna port, runs it through a filter, but a little bit of filtering, and not active filtering, just coils and capacitors and stuff, to band limit to some extent what's going to go into the A to D converter, but then into the A to D converter. And then it makes a huge swath of spectrum and a large amount of data going through a pipe into a PC that then processes everything, puts it all together, and finally makes whatever it is you're going to listen to. Sideband, CW, FM, AM, maybe digital modes. Interesting in that Flex, at the time that this project was being developed in 2008, Flex was still doing their systems where they would do their a couple stages of RF conversion and bring their signals as analog RF into the intermediate frequency area and then take the intermediate frequency and digitize that and send it into your PC. It gave them less to work with instead of having 60 megahertz wide worth of stuff to shuttle over to the PC. They only had a couple hundred kilohertz wide. And even at that, they needed a fair pipe to get from their radio into your PC. So with the 6000 series, we've been seeing that Flex has now gone to direct conversion. They bring the RF in through the antenna connector, they go through a bit of a filter, and then they convert it to digital and process everything in digital at that point. And in order to make that work, they move the processing into their radio, took it out of your PC, put it into their radio, and do all the processing there. And your PC is what they call a thin client, a front end, just the user interface and maybe a little bit of extra stuff. But mostly the computer is just the user interface. It's the, provides the graphical stuff on screen, and the spectrum analyzer, the monitor that lets you see all the stuff on the spectrum, picking the frequencies, selecting the modes, things like that. Okay, so those are the old DVDs. 2009, also on a bunch of DVDs. I think I may have ordered a few too many of these. I had high hopes. I think I ordered like 200 to maybe 300 of each show, of each DVD, and each one has about four of the talks on it. And 2008 sold, okay. 2009, you know, it was pretty bad. Maybe it was the talks that were available in 2009. I don't know. They look interesting to me, but they didn't sell all that well. And got a lot of them left. But somebody ordered the 2008, full set of 2008. These are not, except for Phil's talk on the Mercury receiver, they're not on the web yet. Someday they might be. Also, share the copyright with Tapper at this point. One of the things that I arranged with them was that after, I think, 4 or 5 years, they would get the copyright. The first year, I had a big, elaborate, well, two-page contract with them and with each of the presenters. Since then, we've just said, nah, we'll put this out. Handshake. It's all going to work. So that's the Tapper deal. Dayton. I recorded mostly forums at the Hamvention. On Friday, I did the Tapper forum, and I did the AMSAT Tapper banquet. Tapper has an annual banquet. They share venue, and there's a lot of stuff between Tapper and AMSAT that they share in common, a lot of common interests. So the banquet at the Hamvention is one that Tapper does 1 year and that AMSAT does the next year. So they kind of go back and forth on that. Mike Osman, who is the guy who invented the Hack RF board and is now a ham, 60 days, a ham for 60 days as of that banquet. He is the speaker at the banquet. And, got some interesting things to say. And again, the Tapper Forum will be here on Ham Radio Now, and the banquet will be here on Ham Radio Now, coming up as quickly as I can get things edited. And I'll be working on that pretty much this weekend. On Friday, I also recorded a talk called Techniques of the Best Operators, and that was presented by Mitch Stern, W1SJ. This is one of those things where he's going to give you a long list of shaking his finger at you saying, don't do this and do that and don't do this and do that.
First of all, a good operator gets more enjoyment. So if you're getting a lot of enjoyment now being an okay operator, think about how much more enjoyment you're going to get being a great operator.
All right, so Mitch's talk will be interesting. I also shot the intro to DMR, Digital Mobile Radio. John Burningham, W2XAB, made that presentation, and it's sort of a beginner's idea of what DMR is all about. And I think that will be useful to get into. On Saturday, I shot the DX Forum. I've done a couple of DXpeditions, DXpedition talks, not DXpedition videos. There's a lot of good DXpedition videos. And when I was starting ARVN, and even before Ham Radio Now, looking at what video had been done. Well, part of the reason I decided to do all this is that very little good video was being done. And back in 2004, 2005, very little video was being done at all in ham radio. But the good ones that were out there were on DXpeditions. So I haven't done much of that. And I don't think anybody's going to drag me along on a DXpedition to do the video. A little bit too expensive. They get somebody to do that who can also be a contest DXpedition type operator. What, Mouse? Mouse is trying to figure out where she wants to be. So Glenn Spinelli, K5GS, will talk about the Mellish Reef DXpedition, VK9MT. Glenn Johnson, W0GJ, and Bob Alphen, K4UEE, will talk about the K1N Navassa DXpedition. Which just concluded a month or three ago. The Long Road to Navassa, that is called. And while that's pretty darn interesting, the one I found the most interesting to listen to was Patrick, I'm not sure how to pronounce your last name, Patrick Godier, and he's O-N-4-H-I-L, and Mark Kosmans, O-N-6-C-C. They're from the Netherlands, but the DXpedition was to Kish Island, Iran, EP-6T. They talked about the DXpedition, and that was interesting. And they also talked about what it took to be able to put one on in Iran. So That part was the most interesting to me. And then finally, Don Miller. I'm going to say, because most people are going to be familiar with the call sign, W9WNV, but that's not his call sign anymore. His call sign is AE6IY. W9WNV is now the call sign of something like the Don Miller DX Club. Don is a longtime DXer and DX petitioner, and he will talk about some DX history.
The plan, which was to go completely around the world, not necessarily in one uninterrupted trip, but to get all of the islands and all of the oceans that needed to be activated.
And that will be on Ham Radio now coming up. On Sunday, I attended the Yaesu System Fusion Forum, and I wasn't permitted to record it, which, you know, is understandable, because when you put a program on called System Confusion, tearing apart their logo and making something, you know, not quite flattering about it, you got to understand that they're not going to be too happy about that. Chris Wilson, N0CSW, is the national sales manager, and he put on the talk. It was streamed live by DARA, the Dayton Amateur Radio Association, but I can't find it archived anyplace. I'm going to talk about some of the streaming stuff and some of the other media that went on at the Hamvention in a minute. And there was a guy who was streaming that. And maybe you saw it live as it was going on. I can't find it archived. It might show up sometime later. A little bit hard to navigate through their archive. The biggest news from the talk, they introduced the FT-100, which is a scaled-down dual-band mobile version of the FTM-400. It's going to be an UBOT. You know what an UBOT is? It's a term I invented. I've actually gotten it in QST a couple of times. OBAAT, one band at a time. It's one of those dual-band radios with a display that shows a single frequency. You can monitor just a single band. It can be either VHF or UHF, but one at a time, hence one band at a time, UBOT. Chris said that there are well over 1,500 repeaters on the air. He said he couldn't release the exact number. Folks in Japan didn't want him to, but over 1,500 on the air already. The $500 repeater deal runs until the end of June or until they are sold out. Not sure what sold out would mean, because I'm sure they're going to keep making more repeaters, but it may be till their current inventory is pretty much depleted, and then they'll go make more. I have heard a lot of comments about clubs saying they're going to go get that repeater. It seems to have really sparked interest. Well, if they sold 1,500 in a very short period of time, you know, since late last year, early this year sometime, then yes, it's being very popular. However, you know, that's sort of on the good news side. On the not so good news side of the ledger, the Wires X system, which is going to be their system for linking the repeaters doing the System Fusion digital, has been delayed until next year. They're talking about first quarter of next year before Wires X is available for digital linking of the repeaters in digital mode. Now, the Wires X system works today as a simplex node on an FTM-400. So you can do the digital Wires X today as a simplex node, but for some reason it's not working with repeaters. Repeaters can use the Wires X system for analog today, but not digital. They plan on releasing details at the DCC coming up next October, and I think Chris and I are going to be able to work it out so I can show you that. I probably can figure out what our differences are and, you know, the agrees to disagrees and those sort of things, and hopefully I'll be able to show that when it comes up next October. They're going to have a webinar on June 19th, 2015, 6:30 p.m. Pacific, on the System Fusion, maybe the Wires X stuff. Now, they won't have the details on digital repeaters on Wires X then, because they won't have them until perhaps at the DCC in October. But they will, if you're curious about more about System Fusion, it's available on a webinar June 19th, 6:30 p.m. I think you kind of got to set up, sign up for that in advance. I think they've got a limited number of seats available for that webinar, bandwidth thing, typically. Some other interesting things about the system fusion. NW Digital, Northwest Digital, the guys that are working on the sort of a data radio and have come up with a bunch of other D-Star-ish products, they are working on a way to make D-Star work in a system fusion repeater. So you buy the fusion repeater from Yaesu, and they're working on some stuff that would let it operate on D-Star as well. Not instead, but as well, and it would recognize what your input signal is, and if you send it analog, you go out analog. That's what the fusion thing is. If you come in C4FM, Yaesu's system, it goes out C4FM. If you come in D-Star, it goes out D-Star. It doesn't convert D-Star to fusion C4FM or vice versa. So there's going to be a limited number of ways of that it would be useful, but it would at least add some extra features to it. And also, I was told that some hams are working on ways to integrate Fusion, since it doesn't have its own networking today, talking about some ways of integrating Fusion into the existing D-Star network, the D-Plus network, or the X network, that a couple of different networks currently available for D-Star repeaters. It would not, once again, transcode Fusion to a D-Star and back and forth. They would have their own chat rooms or their own reflectors or whatever, but it would give the Fusion system a place to go be on a network. That is in progress, and I don't have details on where to go find out about that. Let's see. Oh, I want to do a short editorial about Fusion. Try not to get myself in too much trouble with the Yaesu guys this time. It appears that the analog digital Fusion stuff was a smart move. It has got a lot of interest for Yaesu in the Fusion systems, the repeaters and the radios. The $500 repeater deal seems to have been some really smart marketing, because it's getting a lot of attention. A lot of people are getting interested in those repeaters. But what I have heard from some of the people that are talking about doing it, about getting the repeaters, is it's just a $500 repeater. That's attractive. And they don't really care about the Fusion part. They care, they're going to use it analog. They'll probably leave the Fusion capability, but it's not going to be a big deal for them. And especially because it's not networked. And one of the things that ICOM did that was particularly effective and smart when they came out with D-Star was that they came out with it as a complete system. The radios, after they got past the 1200 megahertz thing, by the time they introduced VHF and UHF radios, repeaters were ready to go. The network was ready to go, well, almost ready to go. it was ICOM's or D-Star's networking scheme. It took another year or so before Robin Cutshaw, A4RC, developed D-Plus and made networking work the way hams wanted networking to work on D-Star. But at least it was there. The internet connections were there. So when you put up a D-Star repeater in a town, a small handful of people were going to buy D-Star radios to talk on it. And they'll get tired of, you know, it's an interesting novelty at first, and they'll talk to each other for a while, but they get tired of that. It took the network to bring traffic in from out of town to make things interesting and to make the system something that was going to grow and appear in many, many more places. So Fusion needs the digital side to take off as a digital system. But it was smart to have the analog stuff in there at the same time so that the repeater could replace an analog repeater, add the digital, not chase away all the analog people, and keep the interest up. But without the networking, there's not going to be enough people to talk digital to make that really worthwhile. On the other hand, Yaesu really needs the digital stuff working to do what this is all about for Yaesu, which is selling radios. You're not making any money selling $500 repeaters. It could be losing money, considerable money, selling $500 repeaters. They need to sell the digital radios. And if clubs are putting in the systems and everybody's using them analog, that's not going to drive a lot of people to buy the Yaesu radios, because any radios, including the $35 Chinese FM handy talkies, will do will work through the repeaters. So Yaesu wants to sell radios. And in order to do that, they've got to make, to drive interest in the digital part, and to drive interest in the digital part, they need their network. So it's kind of a problem for them that it's not really ready to go. End of editorial. I hope Yaesu, Chris and the folks at Yaesu understand my point there. And from a marketer's perspective, from the corporate perspective, they can't really endorse everything I've said. They probably are nodding and saying, yeah, it's true. And maybe they'd even come on and say it's true. But it's difficult for them because that's not the corporate line. They gotta tell you what the corporate deal is. Okay, moving on. As I said, there was a lot of video produced at this year's Hamvention. We've seen more and more. Of course, Tom W5KUB has been there streaming live for the past several years. And this year, Dara streamed some of their own live stuff. Let's see, what have I got here? This is the Dara webpage for their live coverage. And they promote Tom, W5KUB, doing his, and their own live streaming. Let's see what's on this one.
I teach at City Mill Academy. It's a K-8 public school, about 1,500 students.
I think this was a talk that was on Sunday morning.
Public school, fairly new. It was built in.
And I actually sent Jeff to view that, not to record it, but to view it. Jeff and I will talk about this stuff.
It's a little distorted, but this is a panoramic shot of my technology lab at school. I call it the 20 rings.
As I was mentioning a little bit ago, it is difficult to figure out everything that Dara had. This is the page which has, as far as I can tell, everything that they recorded. But you get to the bottom of this list, and it says, do you want to show some more? Yeah, more videos. And some of it goes back before the Hamvention. So it's a little bit disorganized. There isn't a really good listing of what's there. And it also appears that they, at least in terms of what's available archived, I'm assuming that when they came in and live streamed something, that the whole thing or everything that they put on there was live streamed. But in terms of the archive, it appears to be short bits. Like from the DX forum here, they're talking about 3 minutes and 29 seconds. Another piece of DX forum, 56 seconds, 25 seconds, 10 minutes and 17 seconds. Let me punch that up and just see what that looks like.
Although if you want to go to any of the Coral Sea Islands off Australia today, you do need a permit. Changed that rule on July 1st of last year. We spent about a month back and forth with the Australian government. They were very, very friendly, very helpful, and in the end told us we did not need a landing permit.
No, I don't want to try a new player.
No camping on the island. They don't want any kind of structures, any kind of people sleeping on the island.
A couple things about what Dara did. They brought in, it looked like an iPad with a lens on it. It was an interesting device. I think I got a picture of it. So just a single camera, and not a very good one. And sometimes they pointed it at the slides, and sometimes they pointed it at the person talking. You can't read the slides. Wasn't close enough to read the slides very well. Looking to see if they ever switch over to the person who was talking.
Kafka, he's the owner, he
And sometimes it sounded like they just had whatever microphone was on the tablet recording. And sometimes they would take a mic over and drape it.
So we shuttled everything back and forth between the storage facility and
over the PA speaker.
The front of the marina where we dumped everything off and kind of a key lock, so you know we had to get keys to get access.
So you could get a little bit better sound. I've tried that a time or two. Just sticking one of my mics in front of a PA speaker, it's always worked out better sound to have a mic actually on the person who was talking. Sometimes I can tie into the public address systems. I usually am able to do that at Dayton, tie into the public address system and pick up from their mic. But sometimes I just, again, a little lavalier mic stuck on the public address mic that people are talking on. In any case, their technology for what they're doing here is not too great. But, you know, they're just getting started. And I've been doing this for a while, so got a better idea what I'm doing. I attended the youth forum.
Can you guys hear me? All right, so thanks, Carol. And we're I thought I'd take about 3 or 4 minutes
I didn't get to all of the youth forum, but I attended some of it.
You don't have to roll your eyes or anything, you know. But it's really a privilege to be here. Yes, mic up, mic. It's okay.
And sounds like they've got a microphone here with our astronaut.
All right, now I can be a little bit more mobile. Would you be so sure? Thank you. So I'm representing the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, NASA, your country's space program, and one of the...
One of the reasons why I went by the Youth Forum, if you've watched some recent shows, I've been talking about the that idea that we are celebrating young hams who... are actually old hams in young bodies, young hams who get excited about the things that have been traditional in ham radio, rag chewing, sideband, CW. We'd love it if they learn CW, contesting, DXing, things like that. And not things that would actually interest lots and lots of young people in getting into ham radio. And I still don't know what those things are. So I went to the Youth Forum to see if maybe I would find out, and not so much. I didn't stay for the whole thing, and maybe there was somebody talking about that sort of thing. But once again, I heard presentations by young hams who were talking about doing things that old hams like, and we were all going, yeah, you love that stuff. That's great. Get off the lawn. Okay, what else? ICOM did a lot of streaming at the Hamvention, and I can't find any of it archived. This is our ICOM's YouTube page. Let me refresh that just in case. No? Not finding anything from the Hamvention that was archived by ICOM, but they did live streaming of several programs. Sitting up in front of the ICOM booth, there was a huge studio for Amateur Logic, for George and Tommy, and Ray Novak got in there. And so they did a live Amateur Logic at the Hamvention. Let's take a look at a moment of that, or two. I've skipped their intro. They got a long introduction on their program.
Oh, hi, and welcome to AmateurLogic.tv, episode, what is this, 78, Tommy?
78.
Live from Dayton Hamvention from the ICOM booth. Say hello, everyone. Hello! Now, there's more people than you see in that shot there, but we don't have a cameraman up there running the camera, so we can't pan around. I see a couple of hands up there, though, so we appreciate you all being here with us tonight. Boy, it's going to be a great show.
So they did that on Saturday. Unfortunately, I was busy at another venue, and I wasn't able to watch it live. Whoops. And they
that's one of the problems here at Hamvention in the Harrah Arena. You can't hardly get any kind of internet signal at all.
And we have people call in from all over the country and talk about their field day operations, and probably some of the most interesting.
They had a lot of folks. In fact, all of the ICOM people were walking around wearing white lab coats.
They had like a chef.
You can see the You can see the coats that Tommy and George are wearing. All of the ICOM folks were wearing these white lab coats. It said ICOM on the front. And then they said amateur logic on the back. So those guys, they got a deal. They got a sweet connection with ICOM. Stop that once again. I don't begrudge that. They've got a big audience. Ham Nation's got a big audience. Tom, W5KUB is getting a pretty big audience. Ham Radio Now, we have a small audience. It's a very high-quality audience, but it's a small one. We'll talk more about that in just a minute. And speaking of W5KUB, well, of course, as usual, he did his live thing. And I also can't find anything archived from Dayton on that. If I look at his archive stuff, it's previous shows. He's doing the roundtable stuff. You see a lot of those. But I'm not seeing archive stuff from Dayton, at least not yet. So we still do multiple cameras. If you look at our old programs from Dayton, from forums, from Tapper forums, things like that, shoot multiple cameras. We get a good, clear image of what's going on the screen, on the projection screen. I don't ask for the PowerPoint or whatever it is that they're using so that I can edit it in for a couple of reasons. First of all, it's a lot of work to edit those in individually. Second, they tend to use laser pointers to point things at the screen, and some people even walk up to the screen and, you know, point at things on the screen, you know, with the projector shining on them, and that's actually kind of cool. So you don't get any of that if you're then editing in after the fact. So I point a camera at it. I get the color balanced as best I could. And then another camera pointed at the guy talking, because some of the time the guy talking is the most important thing. And then usually a camera for the audience, or maybe a second camera with a different view of the guy talking. I think that makes a more professional, interesting show. And I always try to get the best audio that I can. Whether you guys care about that, you know, it's a little bit hard to tell. But those are the important things that I feel about recording talks like that. I also did a few interviews with some of the vendors that are there. In fact, I did an interview with RT Systems and an interview with R-Finder. RT Systems does programming software. R-Finder does a repeater directory application that's available on tablets, phones, and on the web. And they have integrated with each other to do something together. And in fact, when I was out in Hawaii, one of the things about going on vacation is getting radios set up to have all the local repeaters that you can play with in the vacation destination. So Hawaii is a good place for doing that. And I recorded some of the trials and tribulations that I had while doing that. And I expect that I'm going to put that stuff and the interview with RT Systems and with R-Finder and some other stuff about programming radios together in an episode. And it's probably going to take me about 10 years to get that put together, but I hope not. I hope I can get it done a little bit sooner than that. So there's a bunch of stuff coming up from Dayton, and I am going to start editing much of that tomorrow, Saturday, and I'll get it out as fast as I can. One other thing about Dayton, and that's where I bring out Arvin here. People kept coming up to me at Dayton and handing me money because I didn't have a booth. I didn't have a place for them to meet me and to meet Cindy and to make contributions to the show or buy things. So people kept handing me money. And let's see, can I put Arvin someplace? I guess I can move the... Now we're a little bit out of focus. I didn't plan for this very well. There we go. So, this is what people handed me, and I promised to put it in Arvin. So a $50 bill, another, it's going to be hard to get back out. It's easy to get coins out. Folding money, not so easy to get out of Arvin. But he's much happier to be receiving this than, because I left him home. His nose always goes out of joint. Another $50 bill. And this isn't as easy as it looks. Finally, one more $50 bill. And then a couple of pikers, three pikers, you know, who could only come up with 20. I hope you understand that I'm kidding, because it's all very cool. It's going to take me about a half hour to get these things back out. But I promised they would go in. I think they will. We need a tutorial on how to fold cash to go in Arvin. So that wasn't bad. That was probably about as much as I made the last year I had a booth there selling DVDs. And of course, the folks who did that said that they really loved the program. And that's what I was mentioning earlier. The other shows, they have seriously bigger audiences. And I would like a bigger audience, not just because it's more people to contribute money, but, you know, it's an ego thing. And I think that these are good programs. You know, as you know, Ham Radio now has a bit of an identity crisis, or, you know, lack of identity. We cover three different, who have I got?
Mouse.
When they're like batting at my knees, it's very distracting. I'd rather have them come up here and play. Three different things that we do, three different and very distinct things. We do the forums, the Tapper and forums at Dayton, and sometimes other venues, sometimes club meetings and things. We do Skype interviews, pure talking heads. Sometimes at the Hamfests, do talking head interviews and other, you know, just in a booth or something, talking into the microphone type interviews. And then we do a few documentary type field produced programs. That's the least of the things we do because it takes the most work. That may take a day to shoot, but it takes a couple of weeks to edit and get out. So the things that are easy, things we can make the most of are the documentary, or the, right, exactly the opposite. The forums and the interviews can do a lot of those. Jeff keeps bugging me to do some kind of technical stuff, and I have encouraged him. With the camera system that I've got now, we can do more of those. So come on, Jeff. Jeff won't see this. He doesn't watch the show. AC4ZO. We'll do some more technical stuff that he will lead, and I'll just shoot and be able to edit, hopefully, fairly quickly. So that may be coming up. But I want to thank the folks that made the cash contributions, and of course all of you that make contributions at Ham Radio now. I guess we'll put up the little title and say Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. If you enjoy the programs, whatever they're worth to you, blah blah blah, hamradionow.tv, and click on Arvin. You want to sit. Where did I determine that he's on the this side of the screen, I think. There you are. I can never quite interpret what side of the screen things are on, but I think I thought he was over here and then turned out to be over. And it's the monitor I'm looking in front of me, of course, is a mirror of, because it's, you know, TV monitor. It's opposite. Never mind. Unboxing. This came in the mail the other day from China. I think I know what's in it. Not 100% sure. Got a mouse in my lap. Watch the scissors, mouse. I think this should be the free DV, quote, speaker mic thing. We'll just do the unboxing here because I'm not going to be ready to, ouch, not going to be ready to set it up. Great. The mouse jumped down and snarled herself in my headphones. Yeah, the mouse is blind, so she couldn't see that she was about to snarl herself in the headphones. I've never known what the fascination is with unboxings, but they seem to be popular. And I dropped a bunch of stuff out of it. Let's see. Okay, so there's USB cable. You hardly ever see this gender, this style of USB anymore. Not very much uses that. A little bit of wire. A little piece of wire. A sticky pad. And then here it is. The SM1000 Rotel.com free DV speaker mic. And what this will do is let me connect this into my ICOM sitting back here, the 756 Pro 3, and get on free DV. But as I was talking with David Rowe about it in a previous episode, it didn't come with the cables that will allow me to plug it immediately into the radio, because he's not MFJ or ICOM or anybody, small manufacturer. So what have I lost here? There we go. And it's got a lot of connections all over the place. So I'll have to come up with the... also need one of those little power supplies. I'll have to come up with the connectors. And I think the instructions on how to set all this stuff up will be on the web, because no instructions came in the box. There's the push-to-talk button. So it can be a real speaker mic, but it's got connections for external mic, external speaker, push-to-talk, rig mic, rig speaker, you know, lots of different connections. So I'm looking forward to that. I've lost... Oh, but the... Yeah, I pushed the numlock button. And here's how this works. Over here on the keyboard, on the number pad on the keyboard, it's actually my switcher. I'm going to push this button and it's going to switch to that camera right in front of me. And I'll push another button and it's going to switch back to that camera over there. I've also got this wireless keypad that'll do the same thing. Two amazing things about this. Well, one amazing thing about it and one interesting thing about it. There we go. It runs off a single AAA battery, and I put that battery in last October, and I've left it turned on almost all the time. I keep forgetting to turn it off, and it still works. Battery's still good, so it evidently does not draw very much current. It talks to a little USB dongle, and... there it is. I can bring it out here. The range isn't really great. So I have it on a USB extension. But they talk together. The interesting thing about it is that this system is 27 megahertz. I forget where I found that out. It must have been their documentation. It's not printed right on here anywhere, but 27 megahertz. So that's interesting. Okay, so what else have I got here? Oh, talk about Hawaii. I moved my notes. My tablet has got the Evernote file that has my... sort of not exactly a script. Didn't do exactly a script for this, just talking points. So it said talk about Hawaii. So Cindy and I went out to Hawaii for 2 weeks. Part of the reason why we haven't been on Ham Radio Now for some time. and we had a really good time. We spent a couple of, about a week on Maui and not quite a week on the Big Island. Don't spend much time in Oahu. If you're a Hawaiian ham and you live in Honolulu or somewhere on Oahu, mostly we don't go there mostly because Honolulu is a big city and we don't need to see another big city. Now, there's a lot of stuff on Oahu that is not a big city. The North Shore and lots of other territory, but we just haven't concentrated on that very much. We concentrate mostly on Maui and the Big Island. We've been on Kauai, we've been on Lanai, we've been on Molokai. No one goes to Kahalaui. Lots of unexploded ordnance there. And you can't go to Niiau because you have to be Native Hawaiian to go there. So we go to the other places that they let you go. And we have been to the Pearl Harbor Memorial. We've been to the Missouri Battleship and a few other places. We've been up to the North Shore once. But we have not concentrated on Oahu, and maybe sometime we will. But we won't stick around Honolulu very, very much. I haven't walked up to Diamond Head, which is the crater that's just outside of Honolulu. It's a touristy place, but everybody goes there. And someday we need to go there. So we'll probably, maybe next trip, spend a couple of days, either on the arrival or on the departure side, you know, hanging around the Big or the Oahu and the Big Island. I keep wanting to say the Big Island. The Big Island is the island of Hawaii, and that's not where their Honolulu is. I'm getting myself confused because I wanted to go somewhere else here. I wanted to show some pictures. There we go. That's very Hawaiian looking. This is just going to be the little bit of the travelogue portion of the program. Won't be very much ham radio in this. Just a palm tree. And one of the things I like to do anywhere, not just Hawaii, but is shoot pictures of interesting things that might be cool screensavers. So this is just, I think bamboo. Well, no, it's not. It was in a banyan tree, I guess. Or some, one of those things that's got lots and lots of roots up above the ground. A pretty sunset. This is on Maui. What you're seeing here is the 10,000 foot volcano or volcanic mountain called Haleakala. And there are repeaters in a couple of spots along what they call upcountry that cover down here into the valley of the island of Maui. I think I've got, yeah, there we go. Google Maps will help with some of this. This is the island of Maui, and this is the Haleakala Mountain. And this is a mountain range called the West Maui Mountains. And this is the valley in between. And somebody says that in a couple of a thousand years that will have sunk back into the sea. So if you're going to buy property, you want to buy it and then dispose of it pretty quickly. So meanwhile, back at the travelogue, this is the 10,000-foot mountain, Haleakala. So this is sea level. 10,000 feet, and you can drive on a paved road, very nice paved road, up to the top of Haleakala. It is approximately 80 degrees down here. It is approximately 50 degrees up there. And one of the amazing things about this picture is that almost every day, this mountain gets covered with clouds. The summit usually does not. The clouds usually form as sort of a ring around the mountain, and usually pretty thick. So if you want to get something fairly clear, you got to go pretty early in the day. And the time of day I shot this was fairly early, but not super early in the day. There is one repeater right up here at the top someplace. It wasn't on the air during our trip, which was surprising. It's usually been on the air. It's linked to all the other islands, part of their civil defense system. And here, the next series of pictures, we are hiking up the side of the West Maui Mountains. Let's see if I can show you where this is going to be. Right along this spine, this ridge here. Let's see, how good is my Hawaiian pronunciation? Kealaola. Kealaola. I'm still working on my pronunciation. So we are walking up this this trail. And the cool thing about it, you'll see in a moment, is that there's a whole bunch of wind turbines up there. My lovely bride, Cindy, KD4ACW, it's very windy, getting her hair blown in her eyes. So I'm going to step through these fairly quickly. These are pretty much just an unedited, unsorted, just as they came out of the camera, the parking lot when we started our hike. And occasional pictures of just pretty things. You can see right there the tip of one of the windmills. This is an area, and there's a bunch of them now. You can see them kind of lined up like the 10 little Indians on the ridge. This is an extremely windy area. And we always wondered if Maui was ever going to do anything like that. Some of the issues are ecological. Some of them are cultural, about whether or not they're going to be doing things. And you'll see a sign coming up in a minute that will address some of that. And Cindy again, as we're getting closer and closer to the windmills. We climbed a total of about 1,500 feet, I think, and it was a beautiful day. A little warm and humid, but generally a gorgeous, typical gorgeous day for Hawaii. Now you can see the windmills. I think each tower is about 100 feet or so. They're maybe bigger than what they look like in this picture. And up at the top, they've got some signs that tell you about the project. And I think that's the island of Kahalawe, the one that nobody lives on, and there's no roads or anything. It was a bombing test range or something, a lot of unexploded ordnance. Interesting thing about Hawaii is close to the equator, and this picture was taken at close to noon, and if we'd been on the equator and it would have been noon, there would have been no shadow, but you see very little shadow now because close to the equator and it's close to noon. Just more beauty. I may enter this picture in some contest somewhere sometime. It just looks pretty to me. I was going to look this up. I think that's the other power generating station, but I'm not sure what the fuel is. Certainly not coal. Looking out into the valley, and I think we are up on the other mountain. I think this is from someplace up on Haleakala. A big hurricane went through last year, did a lot of devastation. This is a trail we were walking at, and I'm not sure why this picture is where it is, because I took a bunch of other pictures in there, and they're not here. Instead, I've got some pictures of flowers and a guy with a brick pizza oven. This is one of our favorite places for lunch or dinner. It's called the Kula Lodge. It's up at about 2,000 feet or so. So, down in the valley, it can be in the 80s, rarely in the 90s, almost never in the 90s. At the 2,000-foot level, it's usually in the 70s. This is on a road going around the West Maui Mountains, a blowhole. Got some great video of that. And it's about impossible to take a bad picture of any part of Hawaii. Some of the valleys created by erosion in the West Maui Mountains. The road that goes around them. Now, let me go back to the map. I'll show you where we are here. The blowhole and this road are up here. the western part of the mountain in or the island of Maui, and this road narrows and becomes very twisty and turny. And you saw some of the valleys that you see here, and so this is what the road looks like. And this isn't even the narrowest part, but you've got the wall right up against the edge of one side of the road, and not really a sheer drop off on the other, but it's pretty narrow. And now we jump across the island again. This is the top of Haleakala, and we go up there for sunset. One of the things that tourists typically do when they go to Hawaii, to Maui, one of the spiritual things that you can do is see sunrise on top of Haleakala. It can be absolutely spectacular, because usually on the side of the island that the sun is going to rise on, there's a ring of clouds that's beginning to form around the top of the mountain, but it won't cover up the summit. It's usually sitting at the 6,000-7,000 foot level, and again, the mountain is at 10,000 feet. So you go up early in the morning, before sunrise. You know, you arrive there about 5 o'clock in the morning or so, 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning. The sun comes up a little before six, and it can be gorgeous. The clouds can come all the way up to the summit and just totally wipe out everything, or the clouds could not be there, and then you have a kind of interesting sunrise over the ocean, but the clouds make it spectacular, and you'll see in a moment. It's also approximately 34 degrees. And people go to Hawaii dressed for the beach, not for 34 degrees. So you'll see people with their hotel blankets and their flip-flops on, and they are turning blue up on top of the mountain. We know better. So we bring a winter jackets and gloves and hats and stuff like that, and we still freeze. The wind is blowing horrendously up there, and you suffer to see that sunrise, but the sunrise is still spiritual. So what we've learned is don't go up there for sunrise, go up for sunset. Sunset, it's going to be in the 50s to maybe 60. The clouds are almost as interesting, and you can't really tell the difference in pictures between sunrise and sunset. So we'll see some of that in a moment. So we haven't done a sunrise in a long time. These are people, we're not the only ones who know about this. These are more people waiting for sunset. This is the what they call Science City observatories and other air quality and test measurement stuff up on top of Haleakala. And there's a repeater on one of these towers here somewhere. This is looking over at the Big Island. This is the mountain Mauna Kea, and this is Mauna Loa. And I'm going to go back to the map. So where we are is here. There's all the science stuff. And literally standing over here, we saw those people silhouetted. They were standing up right along that ridge there. And we are looking out this direction. And we are looking over here at the Big Island and Mauna Kea and Mauna Loa. Mauna Kea, they're both approximately 14,000 feet. They're within a few hundred feet of each other. The tallest mountains in the chain. I'd go into the derivation of the mountains and how all of this volcanic stuff was, but I've already taken a lot longer than I wanted to for all of this. Mauna Kea is, although they're the same height, it's a fairly compact mountain, and Mauna Loa, you can tell, is a lot longer. In fact, that's what the Hawaiian name means, long mountain, Mauna Loa. Not sure what the Kea means. So anyway, we are standing over here and looking over there, and I think we can turn on measure distance and see from here to here is about, 83 miles. Back to the picture. There's Mauna Kea, about 83 miles away, and Mauna Loa, about 95 miles away or so. So I guess that's cool. Most of the time when you're up there, you don't see that clear a view. That's a pretty spectacularly clear day. That's looking down into the, it's not really a crater, but sort of the crater of Haleakala. And it's filling with clouds. And usually this time of day, it would be totally full of clouds. This is the direction you would look off toward sunrise. As you can see by the shadows, the sun is setting behind me. Pretty spectacular views inside there. And some more silhouettes of people. And the sun is getting ready to set. And I went through some different exposures and different shots of what things look like. And these will be more screensavers, just pure shots of the clouds. The camera was just one of my video cameras, taking still pictures. So not the world's best camera or the world's best lens. But I think some of these pictures make interesting textures. Some of you are going, ooh, ah, this isn't where the repeater is, but could be. Move through these pretty quick because I take a lot of them. And again, I haven't sorted these or done anything with them. People gathered up, a lot of photography. And it's in the 50s probably at this point. So it can be chilly. If you want one of these pictures, let me know. Send me an email. I'll send you one or two. So tell me clouds or sunset or whatever. They do look pretty good, don't they? And when the sun sets, then the show really begins because the skyline becomes blaze of color. Now, if there's a layer of clouds, especially a thin layer of clouds, well above at 20,000 feet or so, then they turn cotton candy pink and it all becomes extremely gorgeous. But today we had a clear sky. And I like these silhouettes. They look pretty cool. And I like that one the best because that is my wife, Cindy, KD4ACW. I took another picture. We staged this one, but she likes this one, and I like this one, because she was just walking down the trail. Hair is blowing in the wind. Totally natural. And that's a little bit of our trip to Hawaii. I've got about 5 hours of video that I will wait to pare down to maybe 2 hours or so. I might put it on the web. If I do, I'll let you know. What else have I got? A couple quick things. An episode or five ago, I had mentioned that I'm not a forward thinker. And I was showing this phone and saying that I'd gotten a call from a marketing company asking if I'd be interested in a phone that does what this phone does. You know, this is an old Galaxy Note 2 now. That's, you know, it's the phone, it's the browser, it's the all the stuff that you get from Google, contact list, et cetera, et cetera. So, I was thinking, no, this is fine. I got the flip phone, and this is the piece I couldn't find. It's not a Palm Pilot, it's a Palm 3XE. You know, so the phone did the phone calls, and this did the calendar and the contact list, and you could take notes on it. I can't turn it on. The battery's long dead. But I think, in fact, it failed at some point. But I couldn't find the Palm 3 during that show, and I came across it, so I wanted to show you that I never get rid of anything. And finally, just before we went out to Hawaii, Cindy and I had our anniversary, 16th anniversary, 17th anniversary. We're old, you know, I'm 65. She's younger than me by about a decade. But we didn't get married until fairly late in life. So we've been married for 17 years. And she sent me an anniversary card. She found this anniversary card that is, although you won't find any anniversary cards that are specifically ham radio, it is at least got an electronics theme. And I was very impressed by it. A bulb, the filaments, two filaments in the shape of little hearts. Happy anniversary to the guy who loves me no matter what. What? P equals IE. An anniversary card with an electronics theme. Way to go, Cindy. I love you too. That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. Look for the Kickstarter. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Over and out.